In the second quarter of 2019, Mergermarket, on behalf of Dechert LLP, surveyed 100 senior-level executives within private equity firms based in North America, 45%, EMEA, 35%, and Asia-Pacific, 20%. In order to qualify for inclusion, the firms all needed to have $500 million US dollars or more in assets under management and couldn't be first-time funds. The survey included a combination of qualitative and quantitative questions. The results have been analyzed, collated, rendered anonymous, aggregated, and presented in our 2020 Global Private Equity Outlook Study. Just a word before we get started on press policy. Please note that the opinions expressed today are those of the individual webinar participants, and they don't reflect the opinion of their firms, clients, or any other related parties. These opinions expressed should be used for general purposes and are not intended to be and shouldn't be taken as legal advice. Further, the opinions expressed during the webinar are off the record. That means they can't be used in any reports, articles, or any other forms of communication without express permission from Mergermarket and Dechert. So let's get started. I'm delighted to be joined today by Ross Allardice, Markus Bolsinger, and Siew Boon, all private equity partners at Dechert, along with private equity industry leaders, Justin Bateman, a partner of BC Partners, and Michael Sanford, Senior Managing Director and Co-Head of Private Equity at Cerberus Capital Management. We're going to both reveal the findings and discuss in greater detail market observations and outlooks. So with those introductions, Ross, why don't you kick us off and set the stage for us?
Thank you, Tom. So as we approach the top of the economic cycle, global PE activity levels have appeared to decelerate relative to last year when the PE market hit its peak. For example, we have seen buyer activity levels fall by more than 13% in the first three quarters of 2019 relative to the same period last year, for both deal value dropping to roughly $395 billion and total deal count dropping more than 360 deals to 2,491. Looking at this same time period, exit values have declined 18% and volumes have fallen by 223 deals to 1,727 exits. And last year, global buyout fundraising dropped by 23% to $426 billion. So a range of geopolitical and macroeconomic factors, together with sellers' high valuation expectations, are contributing to this decline.
Yes. The trade war between US and China has seen tariffs imposed on at least $360 billion US dollars worth of goods on both sides of the divide, and the OECD revised down worldwide GDP growth as a direct response. In addition, the 2020 US elections and Brexit are also playing on the minds of investors. Over in Asia, China's reaching a slowdown in its economic growth, which is also affecting its neighbors. And more recently, there are rising concerns about the future of Hong Kong given the prolonged crisis.
Thank you, Siew. This is Markus. While the past decade has seen private equity build up substantial war chests, in fact, PE firms are sitting on 1.7 trillion US dollars in dry powder, high valuations, as Russ mentioned, which have reached their pre-crisis peak, mean it remains a struggle to put that capital to work effectively and in turn requires a more creative approach by sponsors to investing money. We are seeing buyout professionals move into investing in smaller companies with high organic growth potential, growth capital and minority stake investing, raising long-hold funds, and partnering with strategic buyers on deals to put this record sum of capital overhang to work. On a relative pricing basis, the public markets are becoming more attractive as they lose their liquidity premium over private assets and are accounting for a larger share of deal activity in certain markets. Funds are identifying arbitrage opportunities as valuation multiples in public and private markets diverge. The equity markets witnessed a new period of volatility in the summer of 2019, and any severe drop, such as that seen in the fourth quarter of 2018, would make this even more pronounced, particularly in the short term.
Well, thanks for that, Markus. You You mentioned creative strategies that funds are employing amid the intensely competitive environment. That brings us on to one of the first points that was really apparent in the survey, diversification. Private equity continues to be a high-demand asset class for LPs, but as dry powder levels continue to accumulate, reaching new record levels, the challenge is finding new and different ways to invest that capital and continue to deliver high returns in the face of endless competition for private assets. Our survey indicated that nearly half of all respondents, 48%, said they plan to diversify their asset class exposure over the next 12 to 24 months. Another third, 32%, said they would most likely do so. That brings us on to first question on this point. Michael, I'd like to ask you, given Cerberus focuses on a range of capital strategies in addition to private equity, including direct lending, corporate credit, real estate, commercial mortgage-backed securities, and others, I'm curious as to whether you'd agree this has helped you attract LP capital and compete in today's overcrowded market. And is there a particular asset class that you would prioritize for growth?
Thanks, Tom. We think it has. We have many longtime LPs who have invested across our platform. Cerberus manages approximately $43 billion of capital across the strategies that you've mentioned and have been invested in corporate credit, non-performing loans, private equity, real estate, and direct lending since the 1990s. Our newest product, residential and commercial mortgage-backed securities, is now over a decade old. We think that the diversification of product offerings creates better stickiness with our customers. While there are many talented GPs, we position Cerberus as a one-stop shop for both our LPs and companies that we provide capital solutions for. In terms of priorities for growth, we've seen growth across all of our strategies except for distressed corporate credit. It's been a benign environment for that team for more than 5 years, but we will inevitably encounter a more favorable cycle. The balance of our strategies are less cycle dependent. For instance, within private equity, we focus on operationally oriented middle market opportunities where operational improvements are the key determinant of our success versus relying on significant revenue growth or financial engineering to generate returns.
Justin, I'd like to ask you as well on this topic. Our survey revealed that more than three quarters, 78%, in fact, of our survey pool said the level of interest in co-investment and JVs on the part of their LPs has increased. There wasn't a single respondent reporting interest decreased. Is that consistent with what you're seeing? And what do you see as driving that trend?
Yeah, that absolutely is consistent with what we're seeing. And I think it shows the underlying attractiveness of private markets writ large. Michael just referenced across strategies, but also the benefits of private markets. And private equity has been a huge beneficiary of that over the years. And as it's increasingly understood and delivered attractive returns over a consistent period of time, LPs, quite rightly, are looking at, you know, how do they've understood it more, they've got more comfortable with it, they got used to the J curve, everyone hears the J curve, they got used to that, they're through all of that. And now it's how do we look at this in a more efficient and productive manner? And that's where I think they do turn to things like fee efficiency. We do that in our portfolio companies. How can you do the same thing, attract the same returns, but do it on an efficient basis? And that's a big driver, as far as I'm concerned, behind co-invest. The other thing about co-invest, which is a little bit softer, is when you are doing co-invest, particularly for the larger capital pools that are around, you do formulate a deeper relationship with your GPs because you're working alongside them on deals, you're sitting on boards, you're seeing how they work and see how they do make operation improvements, as Michael was referencing. And again, that binds the LPs and GPs together. So just as an example, over our last two funds, we at BC have done over 6 billion euros of co-invest in our latest two funds. That's effectively more than 50 cents of co-invest for every dollar or euro that we put to work from the fund.
Interesting. Let's turn to hold periods. And consistent with our survey findings last year, long hold funds are a key focus, remain a key focus for many GPs. This year, the survey revealed that 26% of respondents have already established a long-term fund. and 51% are in the process of launching one. That's risen more than a half since last year. On the other hand, data shows that average holding periods have actually slipped. So in 2018, the median hold fell by 10% to 4.5 years, representing the fourth consecutive year the holds have shortened since a peak of 5.9 years, and that was in 2014. Ross, what do you see as driving the rise in long hold funds to start with?
It comes back to the LPs again. I think Justin has just referenced, you know, some of the key factors that are important to LPs currently. You know, the first point is the long hold funds will hold the assets for a longer period than the traditional 3 to 5 years. That can potentially reduce transaction fees for LPs going forward. The second point is more around the buy and build project. So you can really create a neat buy and build story with your portfolio company over a longer period of time for the right assets. We've seen over the past 30, 40 years that, you know, many companies that have been owned by private equity have been held by a succession of private equity owners, you know, some over a 15 or 20 year holding period, which generates value along the way. But for the original owner, you know, that amounts to leaving money on the table potentially. And so I think that's why, you know, those are the main drivers creating these long term funds.
And I think there's one more thing, Ross, that I think is important too. As we're looking, right, people don't know when a recession will hit, but it's on everyone's mind. If you have a fund that allows you to ride through a recession and come back out the other end without having to sell or do something with a gun to your head, I think that's helpful, too, to have that flexibility built into a fund. And so some people think that is attractive, particularly at this point in the cycle.
Let's move on to Justin. So what do you see as being the key factors behind the average hold periods? Where do you see hold periods heading in 2020?
Yeah, I mean, it's an interesting debate, right? You're hearing, you know, long hold funds, and yet average holding periods are going down. How can they kind of sit together and make sense? Well, if you look at it from a fund perspective, I haven't done the analysis, but I'm sure as we went through previous recessions and the global financial crisis, holds lengthened. You referenced they peaked in 2014 and 5.9 years. Yeah, when assets are struggling or you're going through a recession, it's not going to, or there's more chance, a greater chance of not having hit the underwritten case. Multiples are down, exits are tricky. So you hold the assets long. You try and take more operational improvements. Maybe you do something strategically. You do some more M&A. You sell something. There's more to be done, and that takes time. Conversely, if you go through a period of, what are we in, the 11th year of expansionary environment, certainly in the US, Europe's slightly different, but it's certainly in the US, the opposite can happen. You can have businesses that do very well, grow far faster than maybe a firm has underwritten. Exit multiples are going up. Okay, maybe there's a fundraising coming up. There are all these factors that can drive to really move towards an exit. So I'm not surprised to hear that holding periods have shortened within funds and why there's this rather strange dynamic that's going on with long hold funds. If we were to have a recession and things to slow down, I think you'd see them lengthen again.
Do you think having, as Tom mentioned, the holding period shortened to like 4.5 years, we're still outside of the magic 3-year period that a lot was written about when the carried interest, when, like, how long do you have capital gains? But do you think that plays into people's mind when they think about exit?
Possibly 3 years is very short to create the value in any case. I mean, most PE funds and most LPs are, you know, moving into private markets, trading off liquidity for a longer period of time to create more value. So there's a money multiple focus here. But, yeah, I mean, I'm sure there's somewhere in there, indirectly or subconsciously, there may be a flaw that's acting because of that.
Thank you.
Right, thanks, guys. We're going to come back to exits a bit later. We're going to actually segue to a slightly different topic now, setting stakes in funds themselves. So that was something we asked about in the survey. Another trend emerging in recent years is the trade in stakes in private equity management funds themselves. A number of high-profile purchases have been made since the global financial crisis. In fact, a majority of our respondents, 54%, said their firm had sold a minority stake over the past 3 years. And those who hadn't done so yet, 72% said they were considering it. So quite substantial figures there. Justin, again, what do you see as the key benefits of this trend in light of VC partners recently selling a stake to Blackstone?
I was always going to get this question with that recent news, for sure. So happy to provide a little bit of color on that. So we undertook that transaction as it provides permanent capital to fund the growth of the firm, the GP in BC, and enable us to increase the GP's commitment to all the funds we raise. That's good. That aligns us tighter and closer with our LPs, we believe. And all of this is while, you know, it's a minority stake, so having no impact or incredibly limited impact on our governance and our day-to-day operations. And just like other firms have done similar transactions, there are people out there, Vista, Silver Lake, Leonard Green, many other firms, even your statistics bear that as well. So we see that as a real opportunity to enable us to greatly align ourselves with LPs. Furthermore, there are certain value creation aspects. So on the operational side or the portfolio company side, that having access or being affiliated or related to Blackstone enables us to tap into, such as their group purchasing program. This is an enormous program across a vast number of companies and geographies and cost items, et cetera, for us to leverage and have access to, as well as expertise into maybe functional areas like IR or other functional areas for the GP.
Okay. So aligning with LPs, operational benefits. Ross, do you agree with that? Why do you think this trend has been picking up so much in recent years? What are you seeing with your client base?
It's interesting, isn't it? Because this used to be the domain of the hedge funds, and now we've got traditional PE funds, so the ones selling the most minority stakes instead of the traditional hedge funds. For me, it's just a natural extension of a maturing private equity market. And as Justin outlined, there's benefits to both sides, both sellers and investors. For the sellers, you know, they can tap into new markets, new acquisitions. They can fund liquidity for succession plans as well and just tap into new engineering. For investors, you know, buying a minority stake offers them the chance to boost performance and cash flows, so they can come in to the management fees, they can come into the carried interest, albeit on a minority stake. And then striking a close relationship with a GP can result in preferred allocations in a firm's primary fund, for example, as well as potential co-invest opportunities down the line.
Okay. So what's surprising to me, like hearing, like Justin totally confirms what our merger market study confirmed, right, that this, the vast majority, like I think 70% of the capital is used for one way of growth. I was surprised by that when we designed the questions that we were thinking, given generationally where we are in the PE space, that more would be used to deal with succession planning. We're actually like less than a third, 30% of the respondents were using the funds raised with the minority stake sale for succeed, like having the succession of the next generation taking over the fund.
Okay. Let's move on to deal targeting strategies. So our survey revealed that in today's ever-increasingly competitive environment, firms are pursuing a range of different strategies as a means to cope with competition for deals and the need to pay higher multiples. Two specific approaches were cited as the most common, with 45% of respondents citing sector expertise as a key way to add value, target companies, and another 38% citing roll-up and bolt-on acquisitions tailored to their firm or portfolios. I think some interesting findings from the survey there. I'd like to ask Michael, what strategies have Cerberus employed to source and compete for deals in this market most effectively?
Well, at Cerberus, we focus on investing in businesses that we can improve operationally, which may include a roll-up strategy. In order to capitalize on this opportunity, we have made substantial investments in two capabilities to help us source and compete for deals. The first is we have a operations team consisting of 100 full-time proprietary exclusive operating executives, which is among the largest of any private investment firm that help work with our investment team. A subset of that team, about 30 of those individuals are former chairmen, CEOs, COOs, CFOs of businesses that have large Rolodexes that can help us source deals. We've been in this operational business of employing advisors since the late 1990s, so that's nothing new. But what is the second investment that we've made more recently is we've seen so many industries get disrupted by technology. And so within the last year, we started to build a technology team, which consists today of about 35 data scientists. We hired Matt Zames, the former chief operating officer of JP Morgan Chase, and another senior executive at JP Morgan to help us build out this capability. And the idea is really bringing technology to basic industry, middle market companies that haven't had the foresight or the resources to invest in this capability. And so these resources help us source and screen deals as well as work with portfolio management.
Right. A good example there on the technology side. Justin, how important has an industry sector focus been in BC's investment strategy? Attached to that, which sectors do you expect to see most activity going forward in 2020?
In terms of the industry sector focus, that's been very important for us, particularly when we came to the United States about 11 years ago. How do we start thinking about such an enormous market? And I kind of joke and go, well, take the East Coast and West Coast and divide it up. No. Sector was clearly the obvious way to go, and that has enabled us to really develop bench and experience bases across the various different industries within the deal team members. That, absolutely, to Michael's point, needs to be supplemented with operational capabilities, specific operational capabilities like the technological piece. We have exactly the same aspect that we've been focused on as well. But you've got to have them both. And it's not enough just to have an operational Rolodex or operational team on board who are focused and able to turn things around. If the deal team doesn't understand the dynamics in a given sector or a given niche, and investment gets done, it doesn't matter how good your operational team is, they can't turn it around. So it has to be across both elements, and that's why that sector focus has been very key. We've actually really focused and increased the focus on that in Europe significantly over the last few years, and that has enabled us to deploy and reach down into some interesting geographies and sectors and niches within Europe as well over the last few years. And it's in terms of the deal activity, tricky, I think, on the most deal activity. I think it's easier the other way around. In terms of the least deal activity, not going to be that challenging to think. I think consumer is going to be quite tricky. People are worried about a recession, et cetera. I think consumer will be not challenged, but volumes may well be down there. And then, on the most, we're seeing a lot of infrastructure fund raise money, so I suspect infrastructures may well continue to see deal volumes increase and the real perception of downside protection there. So maybe those two.
Does everyone agree with that? Anyone want to chime in on which sectors they expect to see most activity next year?
So conversely, in Asia, particularly in a place like China with slowing economic growth, rising wages, a lot of manufacturing is moving away from China into cheaper neighboring countries. And given the young people in China and the trend to spend on what we call experience, the consumer, on the other hand, is actually being targeted, food and beverage, et cetera, by the funds.
Oh, good to get the global perspective there and the comparison with China. Let's move back to creative deal structuring. Markus mentioned creative strategies earlier in the webinar. It's apparent in our survey that GPs are having to think more creatively in order to put record sums of dry powder to work. So one example of that is carve-outs and take private transactions, been on the menu for the majority of private equity firms. Corporates are coming under increasing pressure from shareholder activists, a trend that's conducive to greater carve-out activity. In the case of carve-outs, activists often push listed companies to dispose of non-core assets, a bid to refine corporate strategies, to free up cash for share buybacks and dividends. The survey revealed that private equity firms are keen to capitalize on this trend, well over half of respondents believing the number of carve-outs targeting their, by their firm would increase over the next year. Public markets are becoming comparatively attractive as private market valuations continue to tick upwards. That's expected to be even more evident if there's a major stock market correction. So moving on to questions on this. So Michael, has Cerberus capitalized on either of these trends at all? And are there any particular sectors or regions where you're seeing the best opportunities right now?
Corporate carve-outs have consistently been a focus of ours, having executed more than 25. The rise of activist investing, you see Elliott, Jana, Starboard, and many others, and disrupting a lot of boardrooms have created opportunities for us. We've seen opportunities in industrial companies, TMT companies, business services, consumer and healthcare industries. Public company investors are demanding greater focus from management teams, so conglomerate businesses or businesses with multiple business lines are under greater scrutiny. We capitalize on purchasing orphan underinvested in corporate subsidiaries or those experiencing operational issues or headwinds. From a regional perspective, this trend, I think, is most acute in the U.S.
Justin,
can you talk through
how BC Partners has applied any of these strategies?
Yeah, no, we've done both take privates and carve-outs. I think on the take private side, the activist or the public activist agitation certainly has shaken out some opportunities. We've done a couple here in the U.S. and we have one outstanding sort of at this moment, and we've done a couple in Europe. The interesting thing is in Europe it's much harder to actually execute on them because of the shareholder vote, which, you know, is that a good thing or a bad thing for overall geographic and geopolitical aspects, but it's a fact, it's harder to execute on take privates in Europe. And then on carve-outs, we've done them, absolutely. Mergermarket, your firm, Tom, that was a carve-out, if you remember, back in the day. But the interesting thing there is some can be trickier. You have a counterparty that you're working with on that carve-out, and that can be, it's not like taking a, you know, fully grown business, which take privates are a fully grown business, or a buyout from another private equity sponsor. It's a business as is. And then you're going to improve it or look to try and improve it over time period. A carve-out, some of it, you've actually got to fundamentally stand the company up in some respects, and that can be tricky. I do think there's going to be an increase in the potential opportunity for carve-outs because of activism focused on corporates. And to Michael's point, the broad spread of divisional discount that kind of exists, or conglomerate discount that might exist to some degree in the public market. So I think it's going to be a theme that's going to carry on.
We're seeing a lot of opportunities for carve-outs driven by shareholder activism. Another trend that came up in the report was companies need to deleverage. Ross, you've advised on some noticeable transactions of late on the carve-out side. Do you see this trend intensifying as well as we head into 2020?
I do, and I agree with Justin and Michael in terms of what they've said. You know, carve-outs remain the holy grail for private equity sponsors. We've seen a lot of platform investments and add-on activity within portfolio companies over the last 10, 20 years. So as a consequence, there's natural consolidation there. And with these add-ons, and as the company and corporates grow, there'll be certain businesses there are non-core to them, but may well, very well be core to sponsors such as, you know, BC and Cerberus. And therefore, to get to the J-curve, as, you know, Justin outlined earlier, there's opportunities within these, call them sleepy corporates, to really reignite existing management teams within the corporates and take the company and create value there.
Marcus, how about yourself? You've also handled some notable carve-outs this year. Would you add anything to that at all?
I think I'm echoing a point that Justin made, and which is another theme, right? How do you find assets where there's not everyone competing for? And because there are so highly complex transactions, or as Justin mentioned, tricky, right? the number of PE players who can actually execute a carve-out that's complex successfully is much smaller. And there's more hair in it, and it requires more work. So I think there's a natural way of having less competition to do those. And why are they so complex? I mean, if you buy something from a big conglomerate that may be all over the world, it's local, the local cultures may be totally different. The way to acquire that local piece may be totally different. It's hard to figure out what assets do you actually need, what people do you need, will the seller give you those assets, will they give you those people, is there a long-time supply arrangement or other long-term supply arrangement, what do you need for the short time? So you're doing three or four deals in terms of all the things that you need to think about and do compared to doing one deal. So it's like super highly complex, which I think that makes it fun and where people that are really good can earn their returns.
I think you wanted to add something on the commerce side.
Yeah, I just wanted to add that in Asia, a contributor to this trend, which is significant actually, is the impact that Japan's corporate industrial restructuring is having on putting attractive and frequently historically undermanaged assets up for grabs, such as the hard drive space. I mean, the catalyst for this is the Japanese pension funds and governments pursuing a concerted effort to raise ROEs in the public markets. That's creating considerable pressure for corporates to dispose of these assets, which are often distinctive global businesses that PEs find quite attractive. So one such example is the $18 billion acquisition of Toshiba's memory and drive business for SK Hynix. And SK Hynix is part of the purchasing consortium that was led by Bain Capital. So guys like Toshiba, Sony, Hitachi. But we also have complications out there. I mean, the Japanese are used to purchasing and not so used to selling, right? So that's presenting itself a challenge for us.
Thanks for that. So let's move on to a couple of other trends we're continuing to see grow. Firstly, buyout shops partnering with strategic partners. More than half of GPs saying they're very likely to consider this deal type as compared to just 25 who said the same last year. A good example there, Siew just illustrated. And vertical integration deals whereby portfolio companies combined with another in the value chain, a trend in which 40% of respondents also said they were likely to consider. So we just had a good example there on the collaboration between private equity and corporates. Markus, what's your experience been on that side?
I'm seeing that right, people are trying to figure out how to justify high valuations and figure out how they can get an edge, whether that is with a strategic who has already the expertise, even though we are, or most of you are, as Cerberus and BC partners, you have your verticals and your industry expertise. Having someone who is in that industry teaming up with you, I think, is an added benefit. It also provides immediate synergies if you can combine the two. If you share them, maybe there's a way of justifying why you're paying so much more than the next person in order to get the asset. And one of the examples that we did recently was J.H. Whitney owned PS Healthcare and teamed up with Bain, who had just acquired Epic, to combine the two, reap the synergies, and basically a joint venture between the two sponsors running and creating a market-leading pediatric home nursing company in Aviana. For the vertical integration, I don't think people have said anything to that. I think a lot of people were looking vertically, like who of our competitors can we add up? I think more recently people have also looked in up and down the value chain, who else can we buy and add to us where we can grab some margins and capture a supplier or a customer, right? Most notably, the one that got challenged, which is another point I want to make, AT&T and Time Warner, where you vertically integrated content and distribution into one company. That deal is a reminder that right? There's not just merger clearance when you do a vertical, when you do a horizontal deal, but also on the vertical, which some people tend to forget. So that's something that needs to be in people's mind.
Let's move on to private debt. Private debt's become fully embedded in the financing ecosystem. Investors have taken to debt funds like never before in the last 4 years. That's in part a function of the low yield environment, which has prompted them to seek credit riskier, higher returning end of the spectrum. In our survey, more than two-thirds, 69% of our GP pool reported that the use of private debt had stayed the same over the past 3 years. 30% said it had increased, and only 1% reported it had decreased. I think those figures really speak for themselves. And furthermore, the survey revealed that 49% of GPs are open to and use equal amounts of both private credit and bank financing. So let's turn to Michael and Justin. Michael, to start, since Cerberus is a firm offering both private debt and private equity strategies, what do you see as being the main advantages to using private credit? And are there any situations where you see traditional bank financing as being more appealing?
Yeah, so at Cerberus, we're organized by strategy. So I'm solely focused on private equity. I have a group of colleagues who are solely focused on offering private debt solutions to many private equity clients, actually. From a private equity investing perspective, the advantages to private credit include, one, they don't require ratings from either Moody's or S&P. So when you're working in corporate carve-out situations, you don't have the financial information that you may need to obtain a rating. That's helpful. Second is you have lenders who have an appetite for more challenged or storied credits. Third is speed. They can act generally more quickly. And lastly is simplicity, and you're just working with a single counterparty. Of course, there are drawbacks relative to traditional bank market. Usually the loan documentation is less borrower-friendly than a broadly syndicated deal, and generally it comes at a bit more of a cost. Your question about the situations where we use it, I'd say each situation is different. So in our portfolio, we use a mix of both private credit solutions and traditional bank financing.
How about you, Justin? It'd be interesting to hear your views as well, since private equity and private debt strategies at VC Partners are fully integrated.
Yeah, so it's interesting. We have, Michael and I, we have our firms, different approaches of the relationship between private equity and private credit. That doesn't mean disagree with Michael in terms of his sentiments in using private credit on the PE side. I absolutely fully concur and agree with Michael's observations. And again, it comes back to what I was talking about earlier in terms of the increasing private direction of travel from large pools of capital around the world, be it private equity, which we talked about before, but private debt being another one. One of the main drawback for those investors can be private. If you're very, very private and you've got incremental information on a given company, that reduces your liquidity, your ability to trade, just the same between public securities and private equity. But if you have investors who are increasingly realizing that's the case and they're okay with that and they have their own diversified structure to enable them to have their own liquidity, but then they have more locked up capital in private credit, I'm not surprised that this is increasingly growing. You also have, on the other side, banks who are, since the global financial crisis, have had a harder time of it in terms of reducing the size of their balance sheet, focus on equity buffers, et cetera, from the regulators. You know, you put all that together, it's not a surprise that this has grown. We at BC have seen that. And actually, just like in private equity, we see the advantages of private equity versus public equity being, in a nutshell, twofold. One, greater access to information because you're private. But as I said, the trade-off there is liquidity. And on private equity, greater depth, knowledge, control, influence, ability to do things with the company. I think that's similar on the private credit side. So we have therefore gone with a strategy at our firm of being fully integrated. We know that reduces our ability to trade. And so that's the liquidity point. The flip side is it gives our credit business great access to the sector knowledge that we've had, you know, many years of history on the private equity side. It allows deep dives onto subsectors. It's looking at multiple different companies in a very deep basis. And then so that can help with deal origination on the credit side. So it's really leveraging that private equity side of the business.
So when you go out to buy a company, you could do the full capital stack? You could do equity and debt on the same company? Or because I understand from Michael and Cerberus, right, you would not, if you do the equity, you would not provide the debt.
Yeah, because we have different LPs in those different funds, and we don't want to run into a situation where there could be a conflict down the road if the company doesn't perform.
Right.
Interestingly, it goes the other way, where we're seeing companies that would maybe an interesting company or an interesting opportunity in a sector, but it's too small for the private equity size of the business that we have at this point, but they're requiring a capital solution. Well, there we go. Private credit can help with that, all the way up to preferred or convertible type structures. So it's an introduction to that company and therefore a connection and a relationship that can be built with that company, which maybe in time is an opportunity from a private equity point of view. But all within the same company, that's something we absolutely wouldn't do on an underwritten basis on the private credit side.
Got it. And so when you're bridging in the private credit, because one of the things we saw in the merchant market is like another thing that people are starting to do is like the tactical opportunities to just do those, right? It's not right private. It's not really private equity. It's not credit. So you're saying you're doing the preferred. You could do that out of your credit fund.
So there are a number of funds around. And ours is a special opportunities fund. Yes, absolutely. That's partly where that's covered, is that or a more of a challenge sort of situation. It's kind of what special opportunities or tactical opportunities is a regularly phrased piece as well, looking for, you know, higher returns than, you know, standard run-of-the-mill, if that's the right word, credit. So higher returns than that, but that comes with a little bit more risk associated with it. But yeah, absolutely, that's what one of our strategies is absolutely focused on.
Thank you.
Interesting. So let's move on to a bit of a regional focus now. So let's have a quick snapshot in each region, North America, EMEA, and APAC, and look at some of the trends that are shaping the market. So private equity here in North America has been on a very hot streak in recent years. 2019 certainly been no exception. Gargantuan deals, such as the $20 billion US dollar purchase by an investor consortium, 55% of the equity in a new corporation created to hold Thomson Reuters Financial and Risk Business, renamed Refinitiv. That was a transaction that Dechert advised on handling on behalf of one of the investors. Deals like that have helped push buyout value to new heights. Markus, which current or upcoming developments do you see shaping the market here in North America going forward? You know, what are some of the biggest factors that you're looking at to impact the deal environment?
Yeah, thank you. So, I think the looming recession, correction, whatever we want to call it, I think is the big overarching thing for probably not just the U.S., but then looking at the U.S. specifically, as the political uncertainty and the 2021 election is clearly on everyone's mind, and all the jockeying that goes along with it, whether that's impeachment or any other the things that people read every day about. And the other thing that I think has become a theme is the higher regulatory scrutiny, whether that's, right, particularly with Siew looking much closer, new rules coming out, capturing real estate transaction on top of what it's already capturing. So I think that is a heightened scrutiny for foreign investors or funds that have a certain number of non-U.S. Investors in their fund. And then the other theme on the regulatory side is the data privacy, whether it's the California Consumer Privacy Act or other things in that sphere. I think that's affecting how people think about markets. And then on the fund side, not the transaction side, the SEC scrutiny on conflict of interest, disclosure, and governance, right? The ILPA 3.0 just came out, the principles on what LPs would like to see. I think those are all themes that our people, how people focus on. But the question when the pendulum swings the other way, right, what will happen to the extremely seller-friendly deal terms remains to be seen. But the terms that are right now, seller walk away, no seller liability on the rep and warranty insurance policies, heavily negotiations around fraud carve-outs, the lack of closing conditions is crazy, and fully backstopped deals are the norm these days. So it would be interesting to see what will happen if the pendulum swings the other way.
Awaiting that pendulum to swing, let's talk about sectors in focus. Michael, you spoke about technology quite a bit and services focus on that sector. So far this year, it's been the dominant sector in North American M&A with $37.8 billion worth of deals, followed by energy. Which sectors do you expect to be most active next year?
Well, Tom, I expect TMT to be busy again in 2020. Technology is reshaping so many industries. So to generalize, businesses and sectors that are more defensive, less cyclical, recession resistant, I think will continue to trade hands in 2020. Whereas I think more cyclical businesses or those that are exposed to potential regulatory changes, if there are significant changes in Washington, D.C. in 2020, will I think those sectors will be slower.
Let's move on to EMEA. Deal activity has been remarkably robust across the pond. Considering the prospect of Brexit going ahead and what the UK's departure means for the future of Europe, it remains potential biggest barrier to investment for private equity firms in the region over the next 12 to 18 months, according to our survey, where 57% of respondents said that investing in the region likely contributing to UK deal activity declining from the prior year. So, Ross, what strategies have you seen European investors employ against this background?
It's incredible, isn't it? So we've had the Brexit vote in June 2016 and the discussion and politicking since that time. And yet, competition remains fierce for assets in EMEA. Valuations remain high. And the most effective PE funds are not pulling back. They have sector teams like Cerberus on the technology side. They have healthcare teams such as BC Partners, and they know the jurisdictions where they want to focus on. In some cases, it may be Israel and different countries, but they put a lot of work into the diligence there, and they'll spend months, sometimes years, getting close to management teams and really understanding the asset. So, I think for me, it's less about the political uncertainty and the macroeconomic outlook. It's more about, as Michael mentioned earlier, the potential digital disruption to some of these portfolio companies. That's what they're analyzing, pre-completion of the target, and how they assess that going forward. I think in terms of the question on, the macroeconomic landscape, it offers opportunities. So funds like Cerberus, who will play to their strengths and look to come into the debt on certain cases and take a control opposite position where it makes sense, and just being ready for that downturn when it happens.
Justin, would you add anything to that? BC Partners has been successful in deploying capital in Europe.
Yeah, no, Ross, I think I agree with much of that in terms of the where we've been deploying capital and successful is we have deep networks in sectors and countries, and you just go deep into that particularly sectoral aspect. And the only way that you can do that is really have a focus and a prioritization. Because you try and do it on too broad a brush, you don't go deep. So you really do have to be very focused and prioritized in what you're going to dive into, and be disciplined on what you're not going to. And I think that's probably the biggest factor. And then go for it once you've really determined that you want to. Yeah, I mean the bulk of what we've been focused on is sticking to the less cyclical sectors that we've all been talking around. So things like pharma, cable, software, information services, again, emerging market, Tom, vet services, for instance, which are more of those defensible sectors. That having been said, there is a lot of the noise that's around has created a really binary, in some a very very sort of binary or perspective from people. This is a good defensive, less cyclical business which is going to go for a high value, and then that is slightly more cyclical, and that's therefore awful. And the valuations, therefore, potentially for some interesting sectors there that have a little bit more cyclicality to it, or as I kind of say it, from a value point of view, have been overly beaten down when actually they're a decent business, decent sector in a subsector or a niche somewhere or other. Yeah, actually picking out a few of those now and again and being very careful and diligent on how you find them, that's important as well. And you can only do that, again, with the deep networks and deep sectoral knowledge and knowledge that you have around a pretty fragmented and confusing in times in EMEA market.
Let's move on to Asia. So we talked briefly about China earlier. The Chinese private equity market is certainly feeling the impact of the ongoing US-China trade war. At the same time, Southeast Asia appears to be benefiting from that. So what would be your take on what's driving activity in Asia?
Yeah, thanks, Tom. Yeah, it is true that there has been a general stalling of deals in China, not just because of the US-China trade war, but just general slowdown in its economic growth. So how have PE firms in Asia adapted in this current environment? In part, they have broadened their minds to other markets. You're right, Southeast Asia, with its long periods of stability, lower perceived risks, lower wages, young, growing, and highly educated population, and actually now a combined 1.4 trillion GDP is at the forefront of the minds of these investors. KKR in 2018, for example, had forecasted that Southeast Asia and India will be big beneficiaries of the war, and since then, KKR has also been making large investments in the Southeast Asian region. But even with these factors, I think the funds are still being relatively considered when investing in Southeast Asia and India, and part of it also has to do with the China story, so it comes back to China to some extent. So, for example, it is a fact that there is still excess industrial capacity in China that could really easily crash prices. If China cannot sell to the US, it will have to sell these elsewhere. Given the Huawei Google ban, it's accelerated China's bid to get up to speed on its own technology curve, and funds would have to anticipate that trend when making investments. Just off the top of my head, would you, for example, invest in a company that manufactures and sells iPhone cameras to Apple when China could potentially come up with phones, a third of the price or a quarter of the price? But from an exit perspective, funds have also had to reassess their exit strategy. There has been a slowdown in appetite, acquisition and investment appetite from China. And so, there are still pockets of industries that are still receiving significant Chinese interest, notwithstanding, particularly industries that touches on the Belt and Road Initiative. So a few of those types of trends and strategies that the fund's thinking about.
Okay. We've got time for one more talking point. We're going to move on to exit strategies. GPs are cognizant that after 11 straight years of economic expansion, global recession is looming. That's fueling the urgency with which GPs are currently pursuing exits. Correlation, as we discussed, median holding periods are trending downwards, falling 10% in 2018 to 4.5 years. That means the proportion of assets exited after 5 years or more is now at its lowest point since 2010. So against that background, Justin, what would you say is your 2020 outlook on the exit environment?
It's not going to be a big surprise, I would think, but it's highly related to GDP and general economic performance. And this time around, very much some more geopolitical considerations that we've talked about at length over the last hour or so. If GDP hangs in there, which has done remarkably well in the U.S., actually, despite some of the tariffs, which has been very resilient. So if it's a milder slowing down, but nothing too dramatic, then I think the exit environment will remain pretty good. We've talked about dry powder, and there's plenty of dry powder around. The low yield environment, again, that's people looking for those higher yields and willing to lock up capital for a little bit more. That's the private equity direction of travel that we've spoken about as well. But I think what could happen is that if it's a real step down in GDP for whatever reason, wherever it comes from, I have no idea, and then almost an acceleration of that, I think you'd see the exit environment dry up quite quickly. But again, because of the dry powder that's around, it may not stall for that long. But I think we've got to keep our minds and everything open to that. And we talked about average holding periods. I think there's a contributing factor to that. If you can get out, you've got a good asset, go for it. So I think, and indirectly or directly, public market volatility is going to be the bellwether to some degree. So keeping an eye on that will be quite relevant and probably a bit of the hair trigger here in terms of exits.
Michael, what are your thoughts on that? Does Cerberus have a preferred exit route, or is it specific to portfolio company and market?
It's specific to the portfolio company and the market. That said, generally, we almost always prefer a sale of a portfolio company to a synergistic strategic acquirer. So if opportunities present themselves, oftentimes we can get what we believe to be fair value from a synergistic acquirer.
Right, we're running a bit short on time. Before we wrap up, we're going to go for each of our esteemed panelists to provide a brief 30-second outlook on 2020 based on their own roles in the global markets and, you know, what they're seeing in their daily workflow. So perhaps we can start with Siew then.
Okay, thanks. Looking at our Asian pipeline, number one, large number of private equity exits, two, larger fundraisers by tech-enabled companies, three, a number of horizontal consolidations in the tech space, some of which are distressed, some of which are in preparation of an exit or both. I expect these to continue in 2020.
Justin?
Yeah, I was touching on it just now in terms of the exit, but looking on the deal side as well, I think assuming we either have a mild slowdown or a benign environment, particularly here in the US, and I think deal volumes and exits will be steady. I call it having a functioning private equity and M&A market, unless, as I say, the public markets get spooked by a real acceleration into the recession or some geopolitical event. The wild card that's out there, which is, you know, 13 months away, whatever it is, the U.S. election. Let's see.
Michael?
Yeah, I think many of the same themes that have shaped the final three quarters of 2019 will continue to weigh on M&A activity in 2020. The trade uncertainty will likely persist. I guess there's a small chance that a trade deal with China could be agreed. And we're entering a pivotal election season here in the U.S., so I think that uncertainty will weigh on M&A activity.
Markus, what are your thoughts?
I think people were going into specifics. I have a more global, general outlook on private equity, which I believe is the superior governance model compared to anything else. And as a result, I think with all the headwinds that were discussed, on long-term, private equity as an asset class will continue its successful march. Investors are and will continue to be drawn to the attractive private equity returns. The concentration of excess managers, as we've discussed, I think last year, will continue, and the best performing PE managers and asset managers, whether through creative deals, sourcing, strategic partnering, innovative monetization of their investments, will raise ever larger pool of capital and diversify into additional asset classes. And we all can imagine what will happen if private equity and the regulatory regime will be modified so that private equity will be available to retail investors. A preference that Jay Clayton recently in September expressed. So you can only imagine what that will do to private equity and alternative asset management.
Ross, what about from your side?
Yeah, well, in EMEA, of course, we've got our own geopolitical event in Brexit, so that certainly will be the key focus for the next 12 months. I think, like I said it before, the growth which the private markets in EMEA has experienced over the last 11 years has resulted in a mature marketplace for PE generally. LPs have many options open to them. Savvy GPs will expand their firms' abilities, as we've heard today, to take advantage of, you know, more prominent sources of value creation.
Right, well, that concludes our session today. Thanks, everyone, for your time. It's been a pleasure speaking to everyone here. I think we've covered quite a lot of ground from deal structures, from exits, geographically. I think that's been a very comprehensive overview of what we can expect in 2020. So thanks very much, and thank you to the audience as well. Questions that have come in, we'll be treating separately after the webinar.